So, good afternoon, everybody from Lausanne, Switzerland. I am Robert Roxburgh, the IOC's Olympic Games Head of Communication. I am happy to welcome you to this virtual press conference on the technical preparations for Beijing 2022. I am delighted to have with us today Juan Antonio Samaranch, the IOC's Chair of the Coordination Commission for the Olympic Winter Games Beijing 2022, and Christophe Dubie, the IOC's Olympic Games Executive Director. With the final Coordination Commission of Beijing 2022 having taken place just recently, the unveiling of version one of the playbooks for Beijing and the ongoing test events, we felt that it would be an ideal opportunity to have a quick briefing with you on the state of preparations. Unfortunately, we're also in the middle of our Commissions Week here at the IOC with a number of meetings going on. So, if you don't mind, we'll need to be quite efficient with the time as we have until about 25 to 5 with Christophe and Chair Samaranch. So, without further ado, I'll hand the floor to Chair Samaranch for his opening remarks. Chair, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Well, we are now coming into a less than 90 days to the Games. 90 days to go. We are in full operational mode. We here from Lausanne, our teams, and the teams from Beijing Organizing Committee. We are very grateful to our friends in Beijing, actually, because they are really going to deliver extraordinary games, even in very challenging period of time, very challenging conditions with COVID mainly. Their efforts are right now coming to fruit, and we can say that the facilities are basically complete in many of the games areas, actually in all of the games areas, including the infrastructure. The services in those venues will be operational within weeks, within the next few weeks. And right now, we are in the middle of the final test events, activities, and training weeks. These activities are providing incredibly valuable lessons to the organizing committee and to the international federations as we go along to prepare for the games to come in February. Well, all China, we feel and we know it's eagerly anticipating these games, and the growing engagement of winter sports fans and digital platforms, both in China and across the world, is confirming that situation. This was evident, especially during the Olympic flame lighting ceremony and the 100 days to go activities a few days ago, like 10, 12 days ago. We are working with Beijing in this changing world of COVID situation to finalize the plans for the spectators, to know how many tickets can be sold, all of them, as you well by now know, in mainland China. But the presence of public will be a tremendous boost to these games and the athletes taking part. Key to the readiness has been the great working relationships with the stakeholders, both within China and from other spheres internationally, that is, international federations, national Olympic committees, media like yourselves, broadcasters, technical people, technical suppliers. We are very happy and proud that our friends in Beijing have dedicated enormous attention to sustainability. This is very much aligned with the principles we presented months ago of Olympic Agenda 2020 plus 5. Carbon neutral games, yes, and they are going to deliver on that promise. First, Olympic and Paralympics to have all the venues powered by renewable energies, solar and wind. Very innovative low carbon emission CO2 refrigeration systems that will be used in most of the ice venues. So all this makes us feel very comfortable that, as I said, China and the organizing committee are delivering on that promise. We have seen also that in the very important aspects of legacy, China is delivering, even before the games have even started. 5 of the competition venues in Beijing, 22, were already venues in 2008. They have been restructured and readapted for winter competition. And Beijing is very well on track to deliver the promise of 300 million new winter sports loving people from the total population. Right now, in the 2018-2019 season, 224 million people already engaged in China in winter sports or winter activities. So the legacy will include other aspects like providing almost immediate after the games, actually access to ice and snow facilities for millions of Chinese people. We have seen since 2015 a great, great increase, like more than 300% increase in the number of ice rinks, more than 40% increase in that same 7-year period in outdoor ski resorts. Well, and to finalize, we are convinced that these games are gonna inspire thousands of children and young students through the Olympic and Paralympic, on Olympic and Paralympic values as part of educational programs. So, as I said, these games, already inspiring to many, will have a lasting legacy, not only for the athletes, but for winter sports, both in China and across the world. And with that, in order not to take much time, I would like maybe to give the floor to Christophe Duby, Director General for Olympic Games.
thank you, Chair, and allow me to share one personal comment. You know, when you enter in this final stretch, you have the butterflies in the belly. You know how it is. It is coming extremely close now, and this is the time where you can not leave any stone unturned, and you have to be incredibly focused. And this is what we are doing, all of us together. And last week we had what I would consider to be a very solid coordination commission. In addition to the usual members of the COCOM, we had as well all international federations participating and a number of national Olympic committees who also helped us. And this followed a series of stakeholder briefings, which were indeed very, very positive, including the one for you, the media. This was more obviously about the playbook, the version 1. Nevertheless, it was really positive, and we got good feedback out of the briefings, and the same for the Coordination Commission, although the agenda in this case was wider. What is extremely reassuring when you go into the last Coordination Commission is when you speak about details and details only. When you don't have any big systemic issue to resolve or to discuss through, it's a very good sign. And this is indeed what we have done, discuss about all the details. And there are many, actually, many details to be planned for in the next few weeks. The venues are ready, and we are going through the final test events. Over 15 test events have taken place. We have a number of them currently ongoing, and 6 more in November, December. It's important to obviously stress test the venues, the infrastructures themselves, but also build the team, train the teams. This is indeed what is currently being done. We are getting, as you said, Chair, very operational. We had feedbacks obviously from all the international federations, the athletes as well. And in general, I would say the outcomes have been very positive. The infrastructure is now complete. It's time to discuss about the overlay, the final temporary elements that need to populate the venues. And we have obviously, as I said before, a number of details to be finalized. And some of you participated in the briefing, you know, for example, that flights and how to get to China is one of the point where we know the principles, but now it's all about how you can actually book your flights to come to China. And this is the type of details we now have to produce for all the stakeholders to finalize their operational planning. The same regarding the COVID countermeasures and the closed loop we know how it will operate, but now the details on a venue by venue level, which of the element of a given venue will be inside the closed loop, which one will be outside the closed loop, which personnel will be inside or outside, are what we are looking into right now. The stakeholders have started to arrive. We have a number of our people from Olympic Broadcasting Services that are on the ground. We have some media organizations that have people on the ground. Also some of our partners that are contributing to delivering the operations that are in China. Now, between today and the 4th of February, a lot of work to be completed, including for the athletes. Many of them still have to qualify, about 75%. So it's going to be an exciting start of the winter season for all of them to make sure they are part of the roster. So this is a very exciting time, and you can hear the excitement from the athletes going through this this final effort to qualify. Should say before concluding that this is the first Winter Games where we go close to the 45% of female participation, which is the highest gender balance of any Olympic Winter Games. So the progression continues in this respect. And this, Robert and everyone would conclude our remarks.
Thank you very much, Chair Samaranch and Christophe, for those opening remarks. Now, and please bear with me as this is the first time I've used this system, so apologies if there's some hiccups. We're now going to take the questions. If you have a question, please click raise your hand. If I give you the floor, then simply follow the on-screen instructions to unmute and turn on the camera to ask your questions. So I'll give you a second to raise your hand and ask your questions. And I see that we have the first question in from Brian Pinelli from Around the Rings. Brian, the floor hopefully is yours.
All right. Hello, gentlemen. Thank you. Question for Mr. Duby and Mr. Samaranch. Just want to know your guys' level of awareness with this luge injury yesterday in Yancheng of this Polish luger who apparently broke his leg and received surgery on Monday. Polish team officials seemed quite upset that there was some negligence on the part of the Chinese track crew organizers, and they're calling for a full investigation. So I just want to know if you've spoken to the FIL, Beijing 22 organizers. And secondly, I mean, is this a concern? Because, you know, this is an incident here at a relatively late test event in the process, which is where we're at right now. Thanks, guys.
Okay, Brian, thank you for your question. Of course, we are very much aware, and we have expressed all our sympathy and support for the athlete. It's a most unfortunate situation, and we are together with FIL, the relevant Luge Federation, and the organizing committee, and the Polish National Olympic Committee. We are discussing and how we can be as supportive as possible in this very, as I said, unfortunate situation. The track and the circumstances under which this accident happened are being investigated by both the Federation and the organizing committee very seriously. And if there are lessons to be learned, as probably there will, we will implement them and have plenty of time to implement. The course, according to the reviews by both international federations that use it in recent weeks, has got extraordinary good marks for its safety and its quality. And we need to wait now for to see how the investigation goes ahead. But certainly we are close to the athlete, as it could not be in any other way. And we will make sure that he's in the best conditions and recovers the sooner the possible. Christophe? No?
Chair, I think ground is very well covered. Nothing to add in this respect.
Thank you, Brian.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Christophe. Next question is by Liam Morgan, Inside the Games. Liam, the floor is yours.
Hi guys, can you see and hear me okay?
Yes, we can. Thank you, Liam. You're good to go.
Fantastic. Thanks for taking the time to do this, as always. For Juan Antonio, I think you mentioned fans and tickets being offered only to Chinese spectators, which we knew already. But at what point is a decision going to be made on venue capacity? Clearly, the IOC is keen that there are as many fans in the venues as possible. But when is a decision going to be made? And just quickly, secondly, what's the IOC's response to the report from the International Trade Union Organization in Belgium today, which said that China should be given a gold medal for repression and criticized the IOC's role in not doing enough to address the human rights concerns that have been raised in the build-ups to these games, particularly in Xinjiang regarding the Uyghur Muslims? Thank you.
thank you, Liam. Okay, on ticketing. We should have by now, weeks ago, resolved the situation of ticketing. But you know, and we have all learned together the hard way, jointly, how difficult it is to make plans in a COVID world. We are hoping that this can be resolved, the capacity on the venues, and then that will trigger all the ticketing situation. But we need to wait and give as much time as possible for our Chinese counterparts of Bokok to make the right decision. We would not like to make a final decision now on smaller capacity because there is some new cases of COVID in China, and then have the stadiums half empty, or we would not like to go also the other way. So we are going to have to wait and be flexible. So Liam, this is not about China or about sports. This is about lessons COVID has left in all societies. We need unfortunately to wait. We are going to try, it's going to be only Chinese, no, it's going to be only Chinese residents that will be offered tickets, but they will have a particular policy in trying to attract also international permanent residents in China, in Beijing, namely, so we can have some more colorful stadiums with different flags. Number two, on the report, I mean, we have had this discussion, Liam, so many times. We are what we are, and we can do what we can do. We are here to organize the Olympic Games as probably the only event on Earth that puts together the youth of the world without discrimination, without difference, doesn't matter the race, the religion, the political system in which they live. So we have to keep that neutrality, and we are going to keep it here in this press conference and for the rest of time. We have to keep that. It's too precious what we're trying to defend. So with a lot of respect for other organizations that have other purposes in life, like the one you just mentioned, full respect, but we believe that our responsibility is what it is, which is to celebrate the Olympic Games as the celebration of humanity all together, despite our differences. So no more comments for me on that front. Thank you, Liam.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Liam. The next question goes to Tracy Holmes, ABC. Tracy, welcome. And thank you for staying up so late.
Hello, thank you so much. Sorry for the delay. It takes a long time to get to Australia and bounce back, I think. My question also is about human rights, but it is regarding whether Beijing organisers, whether the organising committee has expressed any concern to the IOC about the constant questioning, particularly from the West, and whether they have asked you to do anything to address that. If they haven't raised that issue with you, have you actually discussed the human rights record and the focus from the West and how they should handle these sorts of questions when the games are on?
Tracy, thank you for your question. Let me try to explain how it really works. We are the partners of the organizing committee. We are not discussing with the Chinese government anything. We have to make sure that human rights and so many other things in our world, which is related to the Olympic Games and around the Olympic Games, is fully respected. We have, at this point in time, lots of discussions on every single thing, including issues related to human rights, with the organizing committee, and we have that because it's our obligation. We have to deliver, we have to make sure that we deliver Olympic Games that are fully compliant with the Olympic rights, with the Olympic Charter, and whole city contract. So we are doing that. It's not that we don't talk about those things with them. And to the best of our knowledge, we are confident that they are delivering on all their obligations under those circumstances. And we're talking about the organizing committee of the Beijing Olympic Games. Christophe?
Yeah, and Tracy Lamb as well. You know, when we're told that we're not doing enough, actually, sustainability at large, okay, with all the dimensions it encompasses, is certainly at the time when we have to elect a future host, topic number one. And Tracy, we had the opportunity to discuss this. And it's certainly not anywhere down the agenda when we organize the games, no matter where we organize them. And we are working precisely now with the organizing committee on a sustainability report that will cover everything that was done, that is following all the requirements as set off by the host city contract and everything that they have done practically at their level to make sure that the requirements that are established are being delivered and how they are also monitored. So yes, indeed, there is a lot of work being done in what is our mandate. We act when we have a contract, and the contract is the host city contract. And in this realm, we're doing a lot. And when I say a lot, it's the greater we, it's us, and it's the organizing committee. So we can expect the report to be published pretty soon. And obviously, like every organizing committee, after the games as well. And there you can see the whole output.
Thank you, Christophe. Thank you, Tracy. Thank you, Chair. Next question goes to Graham Dunbar at Associated Press. Graham, the floor is yours.
I've clicked all my buttons. I hope you can hear me.
Loud and clear, Graham.
Thank you very much, Robert. A brief sort of housekeeping question, and then flights to China. I don't know if any of us have got any yet. How and when is that going to come together? What's going to be the logistics for actually being able to get a flight in? And in terms of the bigger picture, I mean, surely you see this massive disconnect between the domestic perception of the games as something for there to generate interest in winter sports in China, and the international perception, which is absolutely about the bigger political issues. Do you still think it's appropriate to be using phrases like celebrations of humanity in terms of preparing for this game, when it's fundamental to Olympic values, non-discrimination, which is clearly the issue at stake with the Uyghurs? Rule 50, we can imagine, is going to be tested to the limits during the games. How will that be sort of policed and dealt with? Is that just going to be for sporting bodies, or do athletes face a little bit more jeopardy if they try to sort of go down that the line of protest?
Thank you, Graham. There's a lot in there. I think I'm going to hand the floor first to Christophe.
Yes, and please, Chair, add to my answers, obviously. For the flights, Graham, when can we expect information? We have our excellent director of operation for the IOC, Pierre Ducret, on this case. He's the man who has certainly conceived and delivered the with many partners, but the situation in Tokyo for COVID countermeasure, and is now fully in charge of this operation for Beijing. Now it's coming up hopefully next week, and I hope Pierre will not disagree. And what will come is a system of three different ways to get to China. One will be the charters, and you know that a number of international federations and NOCs will go to China with charter flights, including because of the concentration in the winter calendar of people at a given point in time in a given place, so they can all fly out. We'll have a system of temporary flights as well with a number of companies. They have extended these temporary flights to 15 companies at this point in time, and it covers about 70 cities around the globe. And those temporary flights will fly directly to Beijing, and then we'll have a system of hubs for anyone that cannot secure a spot in a temporary flight. They will go from, say, Geneva to Paris, which has been identified as a hub. And from the hub to Beijing, you will have a number of flights. So this is the system that is being put in place. And everybody is eager, you are like we are, to start booking for these operations. One thing I should say is that the number of people that we do anticipate, and I should have said that in the introduction, is smaller than any previous games. We are only accredited essential people, but it's still well over 20,000 people that will be in Beijing. To your second question, Graham, this is what we do. This is why we do organize the game. This is a celebration of humanity. And this is why everybody is gathering in Beijing. And we'll be living together in the Olympic Village and competing together. This is what we do. We celebrate humanity. We are about building bridges. We are about extending hand across the table. And I say this is probably what the world is in need at present. It's an event where we do just that. Everybody is welcome in Beijing in February. We should not erect walls or build on tensions which are already many across the globe. We are just the reverse. We celebrate humanity, and we should all, including you, be proud to be part of the movement that does this. Nowadays, to extend hand across the table is not always easy, and this is what we do. As far as Rule 50 is concerned, Rule 50 is a rule of the Olympic Charter, and as of anything related to the charter or the host city contract, the governance is really clear. This is the IOC that has the final say with respect to these rules, including to sanction or to inform, as we have done in the past, including in Tokyo, and for that matter, in the context of the implementation of the playbooks. So you see, and any rules that are within our remit, we are in charge of ensuring implementation. Chair, and anything else on this? No.
Thank you very much, Christoph. Thank you, Graham. And now we'll go to sport intern with Ashish Sharma. Ashish, the floor is yours.
Unmute me.
We can hear you, Ashish.
Great. Thank you very much. Apologies, I haven't got my reading glasses on, so I can't see my screen so well as I'm pressing the buttons. A question really just to pick up a little bit on what some of the others have asked. The issue of human rights, there's been a lot of pressure put on China, a lot of pressure put on the IOC in the build-up to this. When you talk about the contracts of future host cities, does the IOC feel that this might begin to play a bigger part and a bigger role in when you come to decide a city in the future that hosts an Olympics, to look perhaps a little bit more closely, not just at issues of human rights, but also in terms of sustainability and environmental impacts, which the IOC is very, very keen to promote. I'm just wondering whether that will eventually become something that influences your thinking moving ahead. Thank you.
Yeah, Ashisha, thank you for that. Of course, and let me start by the end. Of course, sustainability, environment, and all that are critical factors for us to choose Olympic candidates and then Olympic hosts. With the new system in place, with the preferred dialogue and with the new system that has been already used for Brisbane, all those things are on the table very early on in the conversations. Any project that is not sustainable, that doesn't look for the environment to becoming environmentally friendly, and that does not have a perfectly justified legacy, both on the investments that they might want to do, even if those are not part of the Olympic budget, if there are no clear legacy, we do not entertain conversations with those types of candidates. So yes, that is there. Now, you mentioned also human rights and the pressure that we might get. Yes, we understand, but as Director General was saying a minute ago in the previous question, there are lots of disputes around the world, and there are very few opportunities to get people with different views and different systems to get together. And this is, as was just said, this is what we do for a living. This is what we do. And it's very much needed in the world that that gets done. Of course, we will continue to monitor next city candidate cities for Olympic Games. It will be done on all the values that you have mentioned, Ashish. It will be done on sustainability, on environment, on legacy, and on the opportunities to bring the youth of the, continue to bring the youth of the people together.
Christoph, would you like to add something?
The one thing, Ashish, that I would add from a technical standpoint, and this is the interest of people like me working at administration level, is that every time you deliver one edition of the games, the whole set of requirements is being reviewed. And you have basically two things to look at, and this is what makes it really interesting. One are all the technical matters, and you cover a lot of ground, but also societal developments and everything that we see evolving in society is then reflected as well in our rules and requirements. So there is a natural evolution of our contract and the brief. And as you said, Juan, if you look at 20 years ago when we awarded the games, or more now, I should say, Tracy, going back to 93 for the Sydney Games, and the process we just went through for Brisbane, it is night and day. And what we do today reflects what is expected from an organization that has to be at the top of the pyramid and showing the leadership across sport in general, including in terms of good governance. This is what we do, and this is what makes it really interesting.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ashish. Thank you, Christoph. Thank you, Chair. Just a reminder, if you'd like to ask a question, you need to click on raise your hand. The next question we have comes from Liu Yang, I believe, of Xinhua. Liu, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, Mr. Dupi, Mr. Samaranch. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Please go ahead.
Okay. My question is, how do you estimate the Beijing testing games and the training weeks by now for this Winter Olympics? I mean, the venue, the operation and everything.
Christoph, for you.
Yeah, you see, we have very close contacts with the international federations. Can I say that they are not only pleased, but they are very impressed. As Chair Samaranch said before, we have a number of venues which were already in use for the 2008 games, and they are being repurposed for the winter edition. And it's true that when you see the water cube turn into an ice cube and the way it was done, it is really impressive. The same for the new venues which have been built. And as you said, Chair, which have a very solid legacy in mind, everybody that has witnessed those venues really would all concur it's top notch. Now it's only one aspect of the story. The second one is the more soft and human side, which is the training of people and getting them to the right qualifications for hosting the games, but also future winter events. And here it was always the desire of the sports system to help and in great solidarity to make sure that the people in China develop this expertise that will be needed in the future. And I should say that so far, the willingness to learn, the willingness to share as well from the experts coming from Europe or Northern America has been great, and the reception on the other side exceptional too. So if you look at everything we said before, which is the technical level of preparation, including the testing of some of the COVID protocols, it's gonna work. It has been working in testing, and it's gonna work at games time. The venues are really looking very good, and the venue teams, the operators, are prepared. So overall, and in the main, of course, we had one issue that was talked about before. But in the main, it's very high marks that was delivered by the international federations. Now we can't rest on our laurels. We still have a number of test events, including in alpine skiing and others in December. So a lot of work still to be done.
Thank you, Christoph. Thank you, Liu, for that question. The next question goes to Alex Capstick from BBC. Alex, the floor is yours.
Hi, thanks, Robert. Hello, everyone. Just to return to human rights issues and critics of China, back in 2008, the Chinese authorities, I think I'm right in saying they allowed protests to take place, or they set areas aside for protests, at least in theory, that was the case. I wondered if there were plans to do something similar this time, given all of the criticism ahead of these games and the build-up similar to 2008. And whether the IOC would be encouraging the Chinese authorities to do something like that.
Thank you, Alex. That is on the host city contract, and those are the strict set of rules that we have to rule the relationship between ourselves and the organizing committee, with one caveat at this stage. We have COVID, and COVID changes many things. So we are working on the enforcement of everything that the Olympic Charter says and that the host city contract says, but we have to put that under the very strict frame of COVID protection measures that are being set up by the relevant public health authorities in China and internationally. So, so it's still work in progress how these necessary commitments will materialize. And again, it depends very much on how COVID evolves in China and in the venues between now and when the games happen.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Alex, for that question. We're almost out of time. I thought we had one question in French from Europe 1, but I think the hands disappeared. Nope, I'm afraid it's gone. So, and we don't have any other questions in the list. So thank you everybody for your time and taking the time to join. We hope that was useful for you. Thank you to the chair for his time, and to Christoph also for taking time out of your busy days to be with us. And we've given you 5 minutes back, I think, for your next meeting. So thank you very much. And thank you to all of you for your time today on the call. And we'll hopefully see you all in person soon. And if not, in Beijing, I hope. Thank you very much. And see you soon. Bye.